The most actually telling aspect of Morsi's win is not so much his triumph, but the enormous, the dramatic decline of the Muslim Brotherhood that we witnessed that took only 3 months, 3 or 4 months. We have the elections, the parliamentary elections, where they get 10 million votes and grab something like 40% of the parliamentary seat. And of course their Salafist allies got 25%, so they had a majority of parliament, overwhelming majority of parliament. And then you come to the first round of the presidential election and Morsi gets a mere 5 million votes, a decline of 5 million votes, a decline of 50% of their base, disappears in 3 months. I don't think you can find many occasions in history where a movement, an 80-year-old movement, can decline so rapidly. So, and this was a function of the revolution. It was a function of the rehabilitation, the rebuilding, the reconstruction of a political space in the country, a political space that now included millions of people. And that, which brings us to the third, you know, party to this equation, and that's the revolutionary political will. That is the Tahrir platform, if you want, you know, what we talked about earlier. Dignity, bread, dignity, and freedom. And the problem here is that, you know, when you look at the polls, the first round of the presidential poll, which was telling because it was people were voting for their first choice rather than for the better of two evils. And the revolutionary vote, as we said, got something like 40%. And if we count Hamdin Sabahi and Abul Futuh together as representing, you know, two aspects of Tahrir, one secular, one moderately Islamist, and against the 25%, around 25% for each of the other contenders for Shafi and Morsi. And then, but this political will, this revolutionary political will, which ruled the streets really, and the energy, amazingly, did not dissipate over a year and a half, nearly a year and a half. You could still, you know, on different occasions, one most significantly was the 25 to 27 January, the first anniversary of the revolution, where again you had millions of people on the streets. This political will has energized the country. It is the political will that removed Mubarak, that overthrew Mubarak. It is the political will that has transformed Egyptian society, but it is the weakest of the three political wills that unfolded after the revolution. It's unorganized, and it was unable, and this was, and here, you know, we need a lot of self-criticism, because it's understandable that by January 2011, you could enter that revolution, you could embark on that revolution without having crystallized, you know, an organization, a strategy, and so on, because this was a history of, as we said, the eradication of politics. But you should have been able to crystallize that new nascent political, revolutionary political will, you know, in that time. And we have not been able to do this until today.
Now, a day after Mohamed Morsi was officially pronounced the winner of Egypt's 2012 presidential elections, you tweeted a quote from his first speech on state TV, and I'm quoting Morsi, "Don't obey me if I don't fulfill my promises." Why choose this particular statement?
It says two things. One thing is it points out Morsi's attempt to appeal to the revolutionary sentiment of the of the country. I mean, he's been, you know, leaning over backwards, saying, you know, amazingly, actually, women, Copts,
too many
secularists,
promises?
Atheists.
Too
many promises which he can't fulfill. But for the moment, he's, and this is very interesting, again, because he comes into the presidential seat with still the conflict, you know, between the Brotherhood and the military still has not been resolved. They have not, the attempts of each party to basically, you know, get the other party to accept its what it sees as its rightful share of power in the country, it's still going on. And he, and secondly, of course, he realizes, he's fully aware that he won by, you know, by 1% or 2%, that the country is split almost down the middle, and that the people who, most of the people that actually voted for him, not because they did so, not because they liked him, but because they hated Shafiq more. And that the opposite was true, that most of the people who voted for Shafiq did not vote for him because they liked him. And by the way, the revolutionary vote was split between the two in this final round. So he knows he's weak. He knows he does not have a strong popular mandate. He cannot claim a strong popular mandate. And he has to appeal to the revolution. And he has done this fairly successfully until now. I mean, he's, although, you know, starting maybe yesterday or the day before yesterday, it's unraveling. What I wanted to say, why we use this to headline the story that we published on the subject was that it speaks again, as I was saying, to two things. One is appealing to the people, but second, which is no less important, it speaks of obedience. And this is the discourse of the Brotherhood. Now, you know, this is inherent, almost, this is so deeply ingrained. So even when he's speaking of democracy, he speaks of obedience, which is a language of the Middle Ages. It's not a language of a modern state, which he claims to want to build.
Having said that, do you think that Morsi could make a good president? I mean, does he have the potential, the tools?
Look, I expect that we're going to see just a first of all, we're going to see a reign of instability. I don't even, you know, definitely the military and the Brotherhood will, and the military and Morsi specifically, will reach an accommodation. They are bound to do it. They are fated to do it. And both realize that they have to do it. So this will happen. But I think it will be a very tenuous and very uneasy alliance, which again each party will try to keep contesting, and that's a recipe for instability. And thirdly, but you have the third party. It has not dissipated. It has not gone home. It may have been, you know, for a moment it seemed that Morsi had succeeded in putting himself as the leader of the revolution, as the president born out of the revolution. But I don't think this will last. I think once we go into the politics of managing the state under the current conditions and within an alliance with the military, with the constraint of a Muslim Brotherhood ideology and a Muslim Brotherhood platform, ultimately, you will have just huge areas of tension that will keep exploding.
Mr. Shukrallah, my next question would be, in a previous interview, when I asked you about the role of the military, that the military would play in the new Egypt, you said that the military will give itself something like a National Security Council role, will continue to be involved in strategic and national security issues. What is your take on this statement today, and more specifically, what role and responsibilities do you see the military having under President Morsi?
I mean, this is one area where I can claim to that my prediction proved true. If you remember, my book starts with mea culpa, that I did not predict the revolution, I did not see it coming. But I did not accept at any moment the argument that the military are out to take over power directly for themselves. My feeling throughout was that the military is basically out to protect the Mubarak state, which is not a nice thing. So it's not. But I did not believe that in 2012. It's very easy, nor was it in their interest to have, you know, a Pinochet-style government, and they liked their massacres small and contained. They didn't, and they know this is a world. This is not the 90s. This is the world in the second millennium, the second decade of the second of the millennium of that millennium. So, or of the 21st century. And definitely, I do not think that their strategic allies, namely the United States and Europe, would have been at all happy to see, this kind of scenario unfold. And they're very aware of these things. I don't think they are. So, and also, so long as they maintain their privileges, and so long as they maintain their, power over what they feel are the strategic areas of governance in Egypt, why should they be in the forefront and take also the blame? And I mean, they must have realized during these 17, 18 months now that, being the rulers exposes you to a lot of attack. It makes you very vulnerable. The military in Egypt were one of these sacred cows that you couldn't touch. After 2005 you could attack the president, but you couldn't attack the military. Since they took over power on the 12th of February 2011, they became the main object of criticism, ridicule, attack, and so on. On the streets, the graffiti itself is just so telling. So I did not see them wanting to rule directly, and I did not see them, even if they wanted, I didn't think that their allies would allow them to go that direction. Allies that they need, and they know they need. I mean, that's where they get their arms, and the military, does not exist without armaments. So this was clear to me, and this is what happened. Basically, they hold, and they know, they hold the keys to the machinery of the state. They can make, and they can withhold this key from whoever comes to power.
What kind of a relation do you think President Morsi is trying to establish with the army?
Look, I'm sure he realizes that there are certain things, and this has become clear in the past few days, since he announced the winner. All the statements indicate an awareness of this balance. That, for instance, defense, this is their preserve. In terms of appointments, in terms of, they are not about to allow the Muslim Brotherhood to infiltrate the military. They're not about to allow Muslim Brotherhood to infiltrate the police. They're not about to allow the Muslim Brotherhood to infiltrate the intelligence bodies. Obviously, the Brotherhood will keep trying to do so, and this is going to be an area of contention. But again, Morsi and the Brotherhood realized that these are areas which are the preserve of the generals. The generals and the deep state as a whole in Egypt. And the generals have become more or less the leadership, the command of the deep state with the intelligence bodies and so on. And things like foreign relations, this is again, they're not. And Morsi, if you look at his first speech after the announcement of that he won the election, first speech, the one concrete promise he made is that Egypt will uphold all its treaties and international obligations. And this was a message to America, to Europe, and to Israel. It was, we will not touch the treaty. And again, we've had statements that the situation versus vis-a-vis Gaza will not change. So he will not be able to interfere with what the military are doing in Sinai and along the border with Gaza. Immediately, there was this rumor that he was going to go to Iran to attend, I can't remember which conference now, and he immediately denied it. These are things he knows, he cannot touch. And I think it's part of the regional and global also arrangement or of the position or the understanding of what the new post-Mubarak Egypt should be like. I mean, no one is willing to allow that Egypt to become, what the West would consider a rogue state and so on. And the Brotherhood, these are essentially they're merchants. So they want to do business. When you get the man behind the throne is a Shatter, Khairat Shatter, who is a big businessman in working in the furniture industry, for God's sake. So, this guy, he belongs in the world market. He's not about to threaten. And that's the kind of organization we're speaking about. They're not about to threaten Egypt's relations with that global